So hello everyone. So my talk today is things that you can do in order to make your projects, pet projects, better, but it also helps you in your professional projects. So these are the things basically that I have learned over the years, basically because of coming to Python Pune meetups. A lot of things are covered in this in the meetups that I have put it into this talk. Okay, so basically each and every programmer, so every project starts by scratching programmer's own itch. It is said that, right? So it is said by Eric Raymond. So everyone has some problem. Everyone faces a problem in their professional work or in their regular computer usage that they think that if I find some solution, it would be great. If it is, it solves my problem, probably someone else might be out there who is facing the same problem and wants some solution for that. So typically a programmer who is kind of open-minded think that I should make my project open source. And it is always a good thing that you make your source open until and unless it does something confidential or private that you don't want someone to do, like you don't want your bank account to go out, right? But if you are doing something to make your desktop beautiful, probably you should share it with others, right? So the thing is, each project starts probably in the in the night at 2 a.m. or something like that, I think I should start that project. Now I finished my work, but this particular thing is bugging me that if I have some solution, it is good. And at that particular point, a programmer is very excited that I want this solution. So he starts. The thing is, it is important to keep up with all of the things that make a project good in the long run, right? So in the project, in the beginning, the project looked like this, but suddenly after that, when it gets bigger, a little bigger, or someone else starts using it, they face some issue with the project itself. So they report it. When you are busy with your own thing, your own work, it becomes cumbersome to handle everything. So sometimes it is better to do things in the beginning. Before that, the question arises, are the pet projects important really? The answer is yes, they are important. You have to work on your pet projects. It is like if you go to the gym, you have all the equipments in the gym. It is like going to a workplace where you have everything, each and every tool over there, where you, in the gym, you exercise with everything, but you have a spare dumbbell set at home. Basically, whenever you feel that I think I should do some exercise, you have that available at your home. The pet projects serve you the same purpose as that, because workplace, you may or may not always have enough time to figure out things. Pet project give that chance to you that, okay, I think I should experiment this. Because of pet projects, you learn a lot of different things that directly does not affect your productivity, but it has a good, great impact on your daily productivity as well. So yes, it is important. The thing is, if I want to make my pet project better, do I have to do a lot? The thing is, if you look to the list of things that you will have to do, it kind of looks big, but it is not actually like that, because when you do something for your own, it is kind of under control in the beginning that I want these particular things, and I can ignore a few things right now, but I need to keep it in mind. If you have that attitude, it is not actually a big task to cover all aspects of the project. So the short answer is we don't have to do a lot of things in the beginning. We have to we have to think that in the future I will have to do multiple things, so that, for example, you know that I need a project documentation. Whenever if I want to distribute a project, it is important to have a project documentation. Now, if the project documentation you cannot write from day zero for whatever reason, it is okay. You get the thing done, you use it for some time, but it is important that you think it in the beginning that I will have to write the project documentation. Once you have that in place, you have one aspect of your project done. So it can be distributed and people, other people can understand what is going on in the project. So I will be explaining few things, like these are the specific things that are important in order to add some value to your project. So ultimately the goal is to, so your pet project is there, it is functional, but is it better? Meaning, apart from you, is it usable by the other people? If it is, then it is a great thing, so that other people can use it, they can extend it, and ultimately it is solving their problem as well as it is doing for you. So what we will be covering is these are the things that template, how do you structure your project, how do you what are the tools to manage dependencies, test cases, code quality, documentation, continuous integration, packaging, and publishing the project. Now I won't be explaining each and everything, but I will be just listing out the tools that are available. Each tool has its own good documentation that you can go ahead and look at. It is better to always look into the documentation. Hello, am I audible? Yeah, so it is always better to look into that documentation and use that project. It is always recommended that first don't go into a lot of details into the tool that you are using. So let's get started over here. First thing is project template. Project template stands for the layout and the things that basically, if you have ever used a Django project, or if you have created a Django project, in Django you get a bootstrapping script where you bootstrap everything, the project itself. Similarly, there is a tool called Cookie Cutter which does these things for you, which basically lays out your Python project structure. This is the package, for example, this is the package that allows you to create a project directory, create all of the basic files needed, get a boilerplate so that you can get started with your project. Okay, next is, so a few things are there that every good project must have. Give or take a couple of things over here, but the files or directories, which when you look at it, you understand what it does. Also, you know where to look for what things. For example, authors file. In this case, it is just a markdown file, but it is not necessary that you always use markdown syntax. You can use restructure text, anything. The thing is, authors contributing, these are the files that are required that required for the community around your project, so that who is writing the code, who has written the code in the past. Contributing is basically the guidelines, how to contribute, what are the processes for contribution. Docs is the directory for documentation. License is the license file on GitHub project or whatever repository management you are using. Manifest.in, this is related to Python itself. it is the file that is needed by the Python project in order to package your Python package or project, whatever. README is the first piece of documentation that user lands upon. Requirement.txt, again, it is it is for Python projects, which is basically used by your pip, that is dependency management, dependency installer, Python package manager. Again, setup.py, again, in order to install your own package that you are currently in. Or this is the first file that is executed in your package when you install it. Then tests. Test is something that is that contains all of your integration and acceptance tests. Talks is something that I will be talking in a bit later part of the this talk. Then again, your own package. So this package is something that you are writing or you are distributing. And don't forget gitignore file. So if you are using Git as a repository management system, it is important to use gitignore. Otherwise, you will always a lot of things may happen. You can put some temporary files. You can your IDEs can create a lot of files, which basically creates a lot of trouble in your own repository itself, which is not a good thing at all. You can see what is a gitignore file on GitHub's documentation, in Git's own documentation. On GitHub, when you create a new repository, you basically get an option of what kind of gitignore file do you want. You can just select it and it does it for you. The next thing is dependency management. It is one of the most important aspects of your project, as whenever you write something, your package or project use some other libraries that you make that does certain parts of your functionality, right? So you don't write everything on your own. The thing is, sometimes or a lot of times, your machine has have that part of that piece of code or a library installed on it. That's why it works. But it may not always be a case that you have that library installed. Sometimes, if there is a person who wants to use your code, you wants to use your package, and he does not have that library, your code is definitely going to fail. So that is not a very good situation for your package. So that's why dependency management is important. There are tools to you install dependencies and manage them. First and raw thing is pip. Pip comes in built in with a Python standard library. So you can, I think it is 3.2 onwards, I guess, Python. But now it comes built in with Python so that you can install it. Secondly, so if you do pip install some package, it does it for you. It basically goes to, but the default location is PyPI, Python Package Index. It looks for that particular package. It downloads that package. It extracts and installs it on your system. Similarly, the thing is, if your system has a package installed with a different version and your project needs a different version of the same package, and you update that package for your project, there might be an issue where your system may not work or your program may not work, or something is going to go wrong over there. If it is something that this particular version lacks some feature or it may not support something. So it is always important that you use a virtual environment. So in this case, pip env does a great job. Basically, you can manage each project's dependency using pip env. You can just look at it. Pip env is pip env basically just lets you install a Python virtual environment with specific Python version, install the packages in that version, and you can just activate and deactivate this particular virtual environment whenever you want. It is very much helpful when you work on multiple projects simultaneously, and the requirements of that project are different. After that, Poetry is something that I haven't tried yet, but it is a great tool. It is alternative to PPNV. Then again, there is a BinDep. This is a binary dependency management thing. Whenever you are, so basically your Python project needs a binary package, but you don't know that where to grab it from, or you need to ensure that this package is available on the system that you are installing on the your package on. BinDep, this is the tool that comes very handy in certain in these kind of situations. Then again, the next thing is, okay, so now you have created a Python project, you have bootstrapped it. Now you have written some code, you have created a dependency management file. Let's say if you are using PPNV, you have created a pip file, you have written code, it is running. Now it is important to write test cases for that. There are three major testing frameworks, so most commonly used testing frameworks. There are many, but these are great if you want to have something minimal and you don't want to look at a lot of things in order to get your thing done. So there is unit test, which comes with Python standard library also. Then there is PyTest, which is a minimalistic testing framework. Then there is Robot, which is an acceptance testing framework. So typically you write test cases, put it in the tests directory in your project. Then you have a script, or you just install the PyTest. For example, if you are using PyTest, you just install the dependencies for PyTest. We have installed PyTest. And then you run a command where you tell that, okay, these are my tests, and run all of those tests, which is the basic, minimalistic thing to have whenever you are distributing your project, so that you run your test case before distribution, and user will, or user should run the test once he has installed it, so that it can be made sure that everything is working on his system. Also, while contributing, the contributor should also run the test case first. This is something which is for a pet project, which is not, may or may not go into the production, so that a lot of people may not use it, but still whatever is written needs to be ensured that it is good. The next thing is code quality. So as you can see over here, code quality measurements is WTF per minute. So basically, if you consider that it is something that is bothering the reviewer or the maintainer, the less you bother him, it is better that, or the less he gets bothered, the better the project will be. Ultimately, it is going to bother less to the user also. Because if, let's say you have written a project, you are taking care that you don't put anything bad or anything wrong, any stupid code in the project. But if your project is used by someone else and he finds some flaw, or he wants to add a feature in that project, whenever a beginner or a new person starts looking into the project or a code, he immediately thinks that, oh, I think I can do this thing, which will ease up my some task of mine. So if there is no way to ensure that whatever code is going to be added in the project is good or not, then ultimately you will end up with the spaghetti code and you don't know what is going on in the project, because everyone will put the code in his own way. So it is important to have some code quality checks in place, or so the tools for that are so out of these Pylint, Flaket, and Prospector are linting and matrices tools. Also, certain matrices are important, cyclomatic graph and all, which basically tells you that how complex your code is. Linting basically means the styling, code style is according to some standard. If you don't know what linting is, you can look up to Pylint or Pipit. These are style guides for Python. Apart from that, Python Software Foundation has written this formatting tool, which is known as Black. It is same concept as GoFumpt in Go, which is basically a code formatter, uncompromising for code formatter for Go. This is for Python. Black is for Python. Basically, it will correct your code no matter what it is. If it can be passed and it runs on a machine, it will correct it. If it contains some, for example, if there is a line containing more than 80 characters, it will format it. After that, this is a good tool. It is called as Radon, which computes your cyclomatic complexity, your source line code, comment lines, blank lines, all of the matrices, the maintainability of your code. Basically, it checks for how complex your code in terms of if you have too many nested conditions. You can just tell it by looking at the code that it is difficult to keep up what is going on in the code. So it this tool helps you in that. After that, once, let's say you have used one of these thing, you have made sure that okay, my code is in a certain way which is going on in the directory, in the code repository. Now my project is functional, I have few test cases, I have a code quality check in place. Now people basically can use that thing. Now it is important to have some documentation so that if someone wants to use it, or a developer wants to add or a developer wants to contribute to that project, it is important to have a documentation so that it the contributor can understand what the code does. As it is said by Guru Van Rossum, that it is often read than written, the code. It is important. Yeah, so it is important to have the documentation in place. Yeah, and the comments are not always the documentation. It is good to have the documentation separately. The comments in the code are important, but they are for a different purpose. So yeah, so the tools that can be used in a Python project for creating documentation, Sphinx is one of the most widely used tools. You can see it supports a lot of documentation formats, like restructured text, markdown text. I think there are many more. Then mkdocs is also a good tool. Pyco is also one of the best tools. I don't think that it is that widely used, but it is a good tool to have. Next thing is, now, whenever, so CI/CD pipelines are important because you need to have something in place that will check whenever a new code is contributed to your project, it is good and it runs. The first thing is it should run. Secondly, it is passing all the test cases. Also, if something is going wrong, some test case is failing, it should tell you that. In order to do that, you have to have CI/CD pipelines. Now, CI/CD pipelines can be set up locally as well. You can use Jenkins and you can basically use Ansible to run your pipelines locally, or you can do all sorts of crazy things. But if you don't have enough time to work on those things, it is good to have some third-party services like GitHub Actions, Azure Pipelines, Travis CI, Circle CI. There are many services that provide CI/CD pipelines. Now, what happens in a typical CI/CD pipeline is that whenever you push your code to the repository, that pipeline either spins a new virtual machine or starts a new instance where you have the base operating system running, whatever you are trying to test against. Then it needs to install the dependency. Basically, you have to configure the pipeline by yourself. So that VM needs to so you need to install your dependencies on that machine. Then you need to pull your code. If there are some patches you need to apply, you need to apply those patches to the code. Then you need to run the code. You need to run the test cases against that. You need to run the quality checks, the code quality checks against that. And ultimately, if everything goes well, it should be either merged or it should at least tell you that it is going wrong and the builds are not passing. It is great if you could just publish or update the package that we'll be publishing later using CI/CD pipelines. It can be done, but again, it depends upon if you want to take those efforts for the paid project. It is good to have that. So these are the three tools to be used along with the CI/CD pipelines. One is pre-commit. Pre-commit is basically a package that allows you to run test cases on each commit or do checks on each commit with various languages. So basically it supports multiple languages. If you see, typically you have git commit, git hooks. The git hook is triggered whenever a particular condition is encountered on the repository, the git repository. Now pre-commit basically does what pre-commit does is all of the commits are checked using this package. Then there are talks and knocks. These two packages typically are used to test your package against multiple Python versions. So for example, now typically Python 2.7 and 3.5 onwards are currently used in the production. So if you write a package, you want to make sure that it runs on Python 2.7 and Python 3.5 plus, which means basically 2.7 and 3.5, 3.6, 3.7, 3.8. So these many virtual environments you need to test against. So you need to test your code against these many virtual environments. So talks and knocks are the packages that allows you to do that. They're basically using a simple config file. You can configure your virtual environments, your Python virtual environments, and install the dependencies for your package, install your package and run those test cases against that. Now the difference between CI/CD pipelines and talks is your base operating may be the same, but your Python versions might be different. So you need to take care of both of these things. That's why these are separate tools that needs to be used with CI/CD pipelines. Now, if after that, you have, let's say you have everything in place. Now it is good for you to distribute your package so that you have written something that you are using. It is good. Now, if someone else wants to use it, you need to create a package and host it somewhere so that whenever that person wants, he can download that package and use it. So for Python, the repository is PyPI. Plus, if you are not using the repository, if you are not using pip, you want to distribute it you want to distribute it locally so that, for example, if there is a, you have written a package, you want to just install it on a separate machine at your home. Now you either you need to take care of all these things, or you just package it and go over there, extract that zip or tar file, run Python setup.py install or something like that, and get on with your work. So this particular thing talks about writing, packaging your Python code means basically writing your setup.py, manifest.in, and a few other files that are created so that your Python environment can understand, okay, this is the package that I want to, I need to use whenever some input is given. The basic tools for that, the basic packages, that is setup tools, will, and Twine is also a good tool in order to do that. If you want to read more about that, this is the link for the packaging guide. Then after you have packaged it, you need to publish it somewhere, because if you don't publish it, if you package it and keep it to yourself, it is not going to be used by anyone. So there are places where you can use host it. There is Python package and there are other packaging formats also. So PyPI, it is the central Python repository. You can actually use, if let's say you have built a web application and you want to distribute it, you can use these Docker hubs. Snap is something that Ubuntu is Ubuntu is using these days a lot. Then there is AppImage. Plus, on top of that, you can build, create your distribution packages. For example, there is something called as RPM packaging. For RPM packaging for Python. So whenever you use a RPM-based system, RHEL, Fedora, CentOS, you can use this packaging format. If you want to have your package installed using DNF install or yum install, similarly there is Debian packaging and a lot of different packaging systems, like there is YAURT packages and I guess Zapper for SUSE, open SUSE. So these are the distribution packages. These, so I haven't given the links because there are too many of them, and it is better to look into specific distros package manager and how to package it. So it is important to host your package somewhere and publish it. That is the point over here. So if you don't have everything in place, soon after your project gets bigger, you will end up like this. Before debugging, you look great, but once a lot of things are wrong, you won't be quite so. So it is better to have something in place. It is you can put do one thing at a time, and things can be taken care of by later. But it is important to have each and everyone everything in place as far as your project is concerned, because this develops the habit of doing the right thing at the right time. And then just it can be directly used at the workplace. So yeah, so pet projects doing these things in pet projects is important. That is the point. Yeah. So any questions?
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Girish. I had few things, Girish. So
yeah, go ahead.
I just wanted to add few things to what you said. So for package management, we do have distro specific packages like Yum for Red Hat specific OSs, and then DB for Ubuntu flavors and Debian packages. Then to make a platform independent thing, we do have Snap and Flatpak.
Right.
Snap you had mentioned, Flatpak is one thing, and AppImage is one thing. So yeah, these three are platform independent packaging things. So yeah, we can look into
Docker. Yeah.
Yeah, Docker as well. Then there was one more thing regarding the gitignore, which you mentioned. That was we should always have a gitignore file which would omit an unnecessary files like PyCache and other files. So there's a good portal which is gitignore.io. Girish, if you can just go to that portal, that would be good. Gitignore.io.
Yeah.
So this is a great utility which someone can use if want to create a would like to start a good project. You just go and type in here the technologies which you're using. Let's say I am using Python and I'll just hit create. So by default it would create a gitignore file for me.
For example, you want to create Python plus PyCharm.
Yeah,
this will be the gitignore file that you should use.
So it will create, so all standard files which are not supposed to be included, all those things would be included for you from beginning. So you don't have to have that headache for you. So that's one thing. Then okay, so that was one thing. And then regarding the dependency management, you had mentioned about PPNV, Poetry, and other packages. Yes. So we do have Chandan from Python Pune on call. Maybe he has few words to talk about Poetry. Chandan, could you just share about that?
Thank you, Vishal, for asking. So Poetry is another tool for managing Python packaging and as well as for dependency management. So if you are starting a new project, you can generate your cookie cutter like structure using Poetry itself. You can manage the requirement.txt or text requirement.txt with version lock via pip lock file, and or Poetry can take care of that. If you want to build it, install it, generate builds or estate out of it, Poetry can take care of that also. Apart from that, if you want to publish it, you can use the Poetry. And Poetry also takes care of creating virtual ENV for evil. Like, you do not need to manage a separate BNV for that. It will take care of it. Right now, within projects, we find Theta.py nowadays, like you have started seeing pyproject.toml, which got introduced from p517. You can define your builds targets within a single within pyproject.toml itself. So Poetry takes care of that. So pyproject.toml is another. So basically, setter.py takes care of managing dependency and installing it. But pyproject.toml, you can specify your build target like what are the dev dependencies you have, what are the production dependencies you have. So you can directly specify it here. So like if somebody has a use pip file, which got introduced from the pip env, where we try to define like these are my dev dependencies, these are my production dependencies, or these are my local dependencies. So you can do all this, you can put all this information within a single file within pyproject.toml. It will take care of it. You might not be needing setter.py. So you can check this link, pythonpoetry.org. It explains everything in detail about the Python poetry. And it's a very nice tool if you start using that. Like most of the projects are already using it, and they are also using PyProject or TOML.
So I was unaware of a lot of things regarding PyPoetry. That's why I didn't use it. But I think it is a great tool to use. No one, I should try it more often.
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah, thank you, Chandan. That was a great input from you. Thank you, Girish, for bringing up this topic. Like this is the most important topic, what I feel. So only writing code is not that important. Structuring your project is also very much important. So it helps contributors to contribute back and also users to use it in a proper way. So having this proper setup, proper layout for your project is way more important. So thank you.